Now let's turn to another global issue, one that is still with us, but that we desperately wish wasn't. It is, of course, the pandemic. Lots of huge developments this year, from attempts to try to determine the origin of the coronavirus to the staggering number of deaths. Over 5 million people dead from COVID, although the World Health Organization is estimating that the actual figure could be up to 3 times higher than that. Then there's the issue of vaccination and the inequitable distribution of the jab. Then came the new variant surging around the world with extraordinary capability of transmitting. And so, as we enter a new year, big questions remain. How dangerous is Omicron, and when does all this end? Well, for more on this, I'm joined on the line by the respected Nigerian professor of virology, Oyewole Tomori, who's also a member of the WHO's Technical Advisory Committee on COVID-19. Very honored to have you, sir. Thank you very much indeed for joining us, and compliments of the season. Let's just pick up on that issue that you know so much about, because this time last year, we didn't have Greek letters of the alphabet being assigned to different variants. Vaccine was, of course, in its infancy then. Just remind us of what this year has been like in terms of the variant. It's been a year of positives and negatives, hasn't it?
Thank you very much, Charles, and Happy New Year in advance. It's been quite a year. We thought 2020 was bad, but 2021 has been worse. First was Delta, then Omicron, and which is spreading all over the world. At least at the current moment, over 100 countries now have Omicron spreading, and spreading very fast. Many people are dying, and the vaccine doesn't seem to be working as efficiently as we want it to work. And so it's been an annus horribilis, a year that I hope next year will be better.
Yes, I think you describe it very well. It has been annus horribilis. In spite of the vaccine, the pandemic still moving fast, shoring up its own defenses, which makes it a very intelligent organism indeed. And we had a massive Delta wave in the spring, which originated in India and then spread around the world. And now again, we're bracing ourselves for the Omicron variant. So we are all still at the mercy of these variants emerging, aren't we? And they are knocking our lives off course.
Yeah, totally. Totally. I've described the virus as smarter than we are. The world is in total confusion. We don't even know what it's doing. Today we do this, tomorrow we do that. And each time this virus comes up with something different. But one interesting thing I keep asking our people, where are the variants coming from? They're no longer coming from China, where the first case came from China. You have variants coming from Taiwan, not from Australia, not from New Zealand. They're coming from either India, from Africa, from Europe, and also from parts of South America. These are areas, one common thing is that countries where they are strict with their non-pharmaceutical interventions, you're not finding variants coming out of them. It is us, who are claiming freedom, claiming our rights, not using those non-pharmaceutical interventions. They're creating the variants for the entire world. And when those variants come, they're the ones causing all the problems we're getting. Because if we had stuck to the original Wuhan, and the vaccine prepared from them, then what would be a better place today? The problem we are having is with the variants, which the vaccines of the original are not really taking care of. So I think we need to take a look back on what exactly is happening. Why are these variants coming up? Where are they coming from? What is responsible for their coming? If we're able to take that prevention first, I'm sure the world would be a better place.
I think that's an extremely good point. Of course, looking at the fact that, we're seeing different approaches to how countries are dealing with the pandemic all around the world. There isn't a uniform approach. And based on that, as we prepare to enter 2022, are we now more likely to see more of a move towards trying to live with COVID? Is that likely to be the way, or are we going to see things like compulsory vaccinations?
I think we're going to get to both situations. So long as we don't change our attitude, we don't, like I said, we don't sit and look back. Where are the variants coming from? Why are they coming? If we don't begin to look at those simple things, we'll continue to see. I expect more variants to come out next year. Whether they will be virulent, whether they will spread, we don't know, because we don't know what the variants, how they behave. Each one comes with his own whatever. Therefore, I think the world, I can see us living with this for a long time to come. So long as our behavior remains the same, we're creating new variants. Of course, the vaccines we are preparing, you can make new vaccines, but even if you make the vaccines and a new variant comes up, it's the same story we're getting. I think that's the message I think we need to tell the world. What can we do to prevent new variants coming in? And that should be the message for 2022. And I think if we do that, we'll probably be, 2022 may be a better year than 2021.
Yes, that's very sound advice. The ineluctable fact, as you mentioned there, is that the pandemic is still with us. How would you say that scientific knowledge about COVID evolved in the last year in broad terms? I mean, it's been at something of lightning speed, hasn't it?
Yeah, I think we must commend the scientists in the parts of the world where scientists are working, South Africa, Europe, and other places. They are matching, they are finding out when the new thing comes out, they're working on them and bringing out information about them. But of course, we can't say the same for our area here. We're just consuming and waiting for outcome or whatever. But in other parts of the world, and I must commend my colleagues in South Africa, I mean, they're out there up front and giving out information to the world, not consuming. They are contributing information to the world, as distinct from us who are just consumers of information. We need to change on our own side. We need to put more emphasis on the scientists. We need to get a lot of people getting involved in this work and put all, as a lot of the money we're using in the other aspects could have been put into better research and better understanding of the virus than we're getting right now.
Yes, I've always respected that analysis that you give. And with that in the back of our minds, where are we now with attempts to vaccinate the world? Where do things stand, for instance, in Nigeria?
Well, it's always good to talk about our country because it's our problem. In fact, I was just looking at somewhere, I was just saying we have a quinquennium of conundrum about COVID. I mean, five different things. We have vaccinated less than 3% of our people have received their full doses. Less than 5% are receiving the first dose. We are having, you know, vaccine assistance is showing up. We don't have enough vaccines around us. Now we're putting boosters on top of those, you know. So there's total confusion everywhere, you know, about what exactly is happening. I've not received my own yet. I'm talking about boosters. And when I go to the vaccines, I don't get it when I go there. These are things that I think we need to look at each of those problems. And as a country that looks at 1 million doses, at the same time we're talking, we actually supposedly took out 1 million doses and destroyed them because they had expired. The question is, who is to blame for that? Are you blaming the man who gave you food, you know, when you're hungry? Or are you going to turn around and say, oh, I'm not going to take the food is cold, or the food is not to my taste? If we got vaccines with the expiry date, could we not have said we didn't have the capacity to use it within that period, rather than accept and then discover that we're not able to? Or could we have looked at our own system? If we're taking 3 weeks to vaccinate our people before, can we do it in 2 weeks? This is a country that vaccinated 10 million, disposed 10 million doses of yellow fever vaccine, spread over 10 days within 3 states in this country. We've done it before. We've used 10 million more doses, you know, yellow fever campaign. So how come we cannot deal with 1 million doses?
A rather grim note to end on, but wise words coming from you. Professor Tomori, I want to thank you very much indeed, as always. And he was talking to me there on the line from Ibadan. That's it for this edition of the Arise interview. Join us again tomorrow from me and the entire team here in Abuja and Ibadan. Bye-bye, and thank you for watching.